That was not actually my first slide, but it will have to do. Ah, good. So what I want to do today is to talk to you about GMOs. It's probably the worst term that was ever invented to describe these organisms, as you will see as we go on. But nevertheless, most people, especially in Europe, are aware of this because of the publicity that has come about selling you just how bad GMOs are. I'm going to talk to you today and tell you that GMOs are good. Not only are they good, they're going to be necessary. We have many problems. Climate change is really devastating this Earth as we know it. We have to do something about that. As you will hear, GMOs can help. Also, remember that for some 800 million people, not here in Europe, but elsewhere in the developing world, they have a problem. They go to bed hungry every night. Is that right? We can do something about that. Why don't we? For people, we hear an awful lot about medicine and the advances of medicine. But these people who go to bed hungry, food. This is the medicine they need. They're not looking for antibiotics and cures for cancer. They just want food. And we can provide it. Why don't we? I'm going to talk to you today, during my talk, about how we've done a pretty bad job of this, but I will give you some ideas as to why it's all happened. The term genetically modified organism is really bad. There is no organism on this earth that has not been genetically modified. Mostly, this has been done by evolution, but in the case of many plants and many crops and the dogs that we have as pets, this has been deliberate genetic modification. This apparently seems to be okay. No one has a problem with that. It's only now that we've learned how to do genetic modification in a much more sophisticated way, in a faster way, and in what I would describe as a much more precise way. You know, plants, we started messing around with those genes some 10,000 years ago. We start making crosses. Do we know what is in the cross? Most of the time we don't. We have no idea what is there. In the anti-GMO movement, there is so much hypocrisy that I find it hard to believe that people do not see this. Why don't they stop human insulin production for diabetes? Where do you think human insulin comes from? Have you ever been asked if you will donate a sample so that we can help the diabetics among us? No. We've made a genetically modified organism that produces human insulin that we then used to treat diabetes. I'm sure you're all aware of the immense impact that biotechnology has had in the last 2 years, 3 years. We made vaccines. How do you think those vaccines were made? What were the underlying ingredients? They came from GMOs. I didn't hear the Europeans complaining about this. Why wasn't the precautionary principle invoked so that we stopped making these vaccines? And yet, the vaccines have saved millions of lives. They've been terrific. This is a problem. You know, in Europe, you're not allowed to consume GMOs, at least in Europe. You can't go and buy them. There's a law saying that you can't do this. And yet the animals that we use in order to make the meat that we eat, they're all fed genetically modified soybean, other genetically modified crops. Millions of tons are imported into the EU. Why don't we stop this? Why aren't the animal activists concerned about this when we hear that GMOs are so bad? Well, of course, the answer is they're not bad, but for the purposes of politics, it's perhaps better that we concentrate on people and not on animals. You know, when you look at the corn that we eat, there's a typical corn cob in the top right. looks very nice. It doesn't even resemble the original corn, Teosinte, shown there on the extreme left, the wild ancestor of corn that was grown in Central America, and then genetically manipulated through the various domestication processes before it became the corn that you buy in the supermarket today. Now, I just will give you a very brief overview of the science behind this. Traditional breeding is basically we take two plants, one has a gene we want, and we want to move it into the new one. We cross them. The first cross is a 50-50 mixture of the genes. But we don't want all of those. We want to just pick up the gene that we really want. And to do this, we have to keep back-crossing and back-crossing. It can take 10, maybe 20, sometimes 30 years to produce the hybrid plant that we then want to use to make the food that we eat. The original GMO method was developed by two scientists in Belgium, Marc van Montague. And what happened was that they found a way in which nature had understood how to move a gene from a bacterium into a plant. The bacterium was called Agrobacterium tumefaciens. They figured how to move it in. And they realized that just as the Agrobacterium was moving in the genes, we could persuade that bacterium to move a gene that we wanted. We didn't always know where it went. In fact, most of the time we didn't know where it went. But the nice thing was we knew what had gone into the plant. It was very precise. More recently, you've probably heard about the CRISPR methods. This is an even more precise way of doing things. We can cleave a chromosome, the DNA that is in a plant, and we can insert a gene exactly where we want it to go. I'm sure in the future we will have even better methods for doing this. But at the moment, this one is pretty damn good. In fact, the people who invented it won the Nobel Prize 2 years ago. We have a large number of Nobel laureates. This number is actually now up to 166, who all joined a campaign that I started a few years ago, in which we were trying to convince the anti-GMO people, notably Greenpeace, that really now was the time to admit that they had made a mistake. You know, when they first started the anti-GMO campaign, one of the things they said is we need to look at the science. We need to find out whether this technique is dangerous or not. It's not. But Greenpeace refused to come out and say, well, the science has been done, and we now know that this is safe. And why do they do that? I'll tell you as we go on. I rather like this cartoon on the right. You know, we in Europe, in the developed world, we go into a restaurant or we go into a supermarket, we have a choice. We can choose what we want to eat. If something is marked GMO, you don't have to eat it, you don't have to buy it, you have a choice. But this young man in Africa, he just wants to eat. He just wants a food that will keep him alive. He doesn't have that choice. To tell you some idea, to give you an idea, a very simple idea of how the modern precision techniques work, I like to use this analogy. I want to move a GPS system from my old car into my new one. Do I take the two cars apart and then mix all the parts, put them back together, and pick up the version of the car that has the GPS? No, I don't. I unplug the GPS, I put it into my new car. That is the GMO method for improving foods. That is the GMO approach to crop breeding. If I take the GPS from an airplane, is this going to make the car fly? You listen to the GMO activists, the anti-GMO activists. They will tell you, you take it from a salmon, this plant is going to swim. It's nonsense. There is so much nonsense that has been produced, and it's been produced to scare you. You know, politicians have a big habit of saying, well, this is very dangerous, and I'm going to protect you from it. And this was the approach that Greenpeace took. We have to remember that what's important is not the product, is not the method, rather, but rather it's the product. You want to know, is the product safe? If a lady goes into a store to buy a nice dress, most of the time she's looking for the quality of the dress. Is it a good one? Does it look good on me? She doesn't want to know how it was made. Most of the time, you're looking for the quality of the product. This is also true, and should be true, for traditional breeding. That is, just as you want to test whether GMO products are safe, you also want to know that the traditional products are safe. I want to move now to food in developing countries, and we have to remember that the real difference between the food that we eat in the developed world and that in the developing world is that big agricultural companies have been very successful in breeding plants so that they taste good, the final product, so that they grow fast, so that they have high yields. There has been millions, billions of dollars invested in improving the crops that you and I eat. No such investment has been made in the developing world. Why? Because the companies cannot make money in the developing world. There is no money. Money. You want to know why people do things? Just ask, where is the money? Look for the money, or look for the power that taking a particular position uses. Now, the thing about GMOs is that Europe never needed them, but the developing world really does. So why doesn't Europe endorse this? Europeans are nice people, they're good people. We want to help our fellow citizens. We really do want to rehumanize the world. So why don't we do it? Could it be politics? Could it be money? Well, I will argue it is both. The Europeans didn't want the US agricultural companies to dominate the market. They didn't want these big agro-businesses to control the food supply in Europe. And there was a lot of sentiment against this. And so what do? You ban Monsanto, you try to ban, you can't do that because they actually turn out to provide all the seeds that everybody needs. So what are you going to do? Well, Monsanto made a huge mistake. They introduced a genetically modified crop with the Roundup Ready symbol into Europe. And stupidly, instead of lowering the price and encouraging to buy it, they charge more for these seeds because they grew better. They were easier for farmers to use. And Greenpeace leapt on this, and they said, well, we're going to say that GMOs must be dangerous because it's only just been done. This was 30 years ago now. It's only just been done. How do we know that they're safe? Now, Greenpeace have quite a bit of money, and they got movies made. They had advertising in order to show you how dangerous it was. They took Hollywood scriptwriters who write all these really horrible, nasty movies, scaring everybody. They used this advertising in order to go against GMOs. We scientists tried to fight back against this, but when I write a grant, I cannot include a line item for advertising so that I can go out and show how good my science is. We have to rely upon the fact that it leads to useful innovations, good innovations. And so Greenpeace made hay with this. They were successful in passing anti-GMO laws. They were successful in scaring everybody. They managed to get a lot of political power as a result of all of this. And the best of all, zero economic consequences for Europe, because Europe didn't need GMOs. Now, I have a hard time with this precautionary principle, which is so common here in Europe. You know, if you're going to really take extreme precautions, nothing new is ever going to come. I bet every single one of you has a cell phone in their pocket. Do you know how dangerous cell phones are? Why weren't these banned? They're not dangerous because of the microwave radiation. They're dangerous because the screens emit blue light, which affects the macula of the eye. And we're now seeing macular degeneration occurring among young people at a much, much higher rate than it ever used to. Why were these not stopped by the precautionary principle? And so here we come to the hypocrisy that is just everywhere. Diabetics, I've mentioned already, cheese, wine, bread, they are genetically modified organisms that help the producers to make cheese and wine and bread. And unfortunately, not content with focusing on Europe and really just going after Europe, the anti-GMO evangelists went around the world and convinced leaders in many developing countries that GMOs were dangerous and so they shouldn't use them. I want to give you just one example of a really good, interesting story. Vitamin A deficiency is a major, major problem. Today, somewhere between 250,000 and 500,000 children die every year because they don't get enough vitamin A. This is not a developed world problem, this is a developing world problem. And a man called Peter Jennings, back in 1984, said, well, why don't we do the following? A lot of the food that these people consume, which doesn't produce the beta carotene needed to make vitamin A lot of the food they produce is rice. Rice is a nice white color, and that's because it doesn't have any beta carotene in the grain itself. And so this idea of putting the gene for beta carotene, actually it's two genes to make them, you put them into rice, and now you get golden rice, shown here on the right. And this provides the precursor of vitamin A and can prevent childhood blindness. It's not a problem we have in the West, because either you take vitamin D as vitamin A as a supplement, or you eat carrots, or you eat vegetables. You have so many ways in which you can get it. It's not true in the developing world. So this became a reality. These two men, Ingo Petraikis and Peter Beyer, figured out how to get rice to put beta carotene into the grain. 1999, it's 24 years ago. If this was not a GMO, this would have been in commercial production maybe 2 to 5 years later, very soon. And it could have been given out to all of the developing world countries that needed it. It was not patented. Well, it was patented, but there was a free license to anybody in the developed world who wanted to grow it. So it was without cost, could have been distributed the seeds very easily. But it's a GMO. And Greenpeace recognized that this was a problem, because if this is allowed, if one allows this, what's to stop people allowing everything? And so they went out of their way to stop this. You would not believe the lengths they went through to try and stop it. Multiple years of delay. And it's only late last year that the government of the Philippines agreed that this was okay, commercial production has started, and it is now available, but only in the Philippines. Many other countries need it. In fact, I'm going to Bangladesh soon to talk to the agricultural minister, I hope the prime minister there, to talk specifically about how Bangladesh should adopt this, and they've adopted others. Millions of children have died because of vitamin A deficiency, and we had a solution. Is this not, words escape me. This is a crime against humanity to be doing this, to stopping the availability of these crops that can save lives. We have to do something about it. In Bangladesh, they approved BT brinjal. Brinjal is eggplant to those of us in the West. That was approved. Took a long time, and now they grow so much brinjal, they can't eat it all. They export it. Many of these other things too. Very interesting set of compounds, of crops that have been genetically modified to improve their accessibility. Many are under development. In fact, bananas are a major problem. Bananas have been so heavily genetically modified over the years that it is now very difficult to, by traditional methods, to do anything. And there is a particular fungus that affects bananas. There's a microorganism, a bacterium that affects bananas. And scientists in Kenya have figured out how to stop this. The Parliament of Uganda says, fine, grow them, let's get going. But the wife and daughter of the president of Uganda were got to by the anti-GMO activists who convinced them that they shouldn't do this. And the president, who himself is personally in favor of GMOs, sent it back to the parliament with a whole load of, you've got to change this and this and this, which would have made it virtually impossible to accomplish. My statement is that if you don't want to eat GMOs, don't. It's entirely up to you. You know, I happen to be a vegetarian. I don't like meat. I don't eat meat. It's not because I think meat's dangerous. I just don't like it. I don't like the texture of it. If you don't like GMOs, don't eat them. You have this choice. There are plenty of alternatives. And if anything, the GMOs are probably better than traditional foods, because when you make a traditional hybrid, you don't quite know what all the genes are. When we make a GMO crop, we know what is the new gene that we've put in. As I say, developed countries, no problem with food. But we must never forget the consequences of what we do here in the developed world, and especially with the internet, with social media. We can't do anything here that doesn't spread all around the world. And if you're doing something for a political reason in your home country, make sure that you do not allow that same message to just be distributed around the world to places where perhaps the same message is not appropriate. We need a lot more science in politics, and just speaking from as a scientist, I think we could do with a little less politics in science. Politicians should really listen to the science they fund. You know, in the US, we have the National Institutes of Health. In the EU, you have many bodies that produce funds to support scientists. Politicians in general are supportive of this. But why don't they listen to the scientists who speak, who have used this money to help improve mankind? We must simply stop producing, stop supporting this idea that GMOs are dangerous. And I think civil society needs to play a role too. I spoke to the Pope. I've been trying to persuade him to say something that backs up what we as Nobel laureates say, that GMOs are safe. Privately, he admits they're safe, but he says they're being used by the companies to make smallholder farmers impoverished, buy their land, and so on. There's an Argentinian economist who is supporting this view. But it's not true. If you look at the statistics, you look at the evidence, the big agricultural companies are not taking over all of the smallholder farmers. Rather, the smallholder farmers are benefit from access to the GMOs. The Rotary Clubs are very good. Influential celebrities, you know, Hollywood stars, football stars can speak up about it. And I really have to criticize the media, because the media often does not present science fiction in a proper way. They always try to say it's a 50-50 thing. They want people arguing one way or the other. Climate change, you see this. GMOs, you see this. But it's not right. Most scientists know that we are responsible for climate change, Most scientists know that GMOs are safe. The only good thing that's come out of the Catholic Church recently, if you go and you go through the sacrament of the Eucharist, they say that if the wine and the bread that is consumed at the Eucharistic ceremonies, if it comes from a genetically modified organism, it's okay. It's genuine material. Bear that in mind for those of you who are Catholic. We have some positive signs coming. Finland's Green Party and so on, a number of other places are all supporting this. I think there are changes coming in Europe, but we need people to speak out, and we need the young people especially to speak out. You know, this is your world that you inherit, you're going to inherit, and you're going to run. And I just want to finish with this. I rather like this picture that was produced by a fellow over in the US who says, you know, non-GMO is an indulgence of the Western world. We have a choice. You know, you don't go to a restaurant and say, oh, can I eat today? You say, well, what will I have? Maybe this or this or this. That is not true in the developing world. They need all the food that we can produce for them. Please support GMOs. Thank you.